Good morning, everybody, and a very warm welcome on this beautiful sunny morning to our service here on YouTube for the United Benefice of St. Mary's and St. Mark's. It's lovely to be able to welcome you here for morning worship this morning, to be able to have you with us in this way. As we stand at the end of a week where there's been various different announcements, it's just good to acknowledge that in all things our God is with us. Our God is for us and not against us. And we're going to be looking this morning, we're continuing going through the lectionary, and we're looking this morning at the passage which is familiar to some but often skipped over as well because it's a difficult one, in Mark chapter 8, where Jesus is rebuking Peter. And so we're going to be looking a little bit at that a little later in the service. And so we hope that this morning is a blessing to you. But more than that, we hope that this morning is a blessing to God. You know, that is the purpose of worship, is not to go so that we may receive a blessing, though God in his grace does do that. The purpose of worship is to bless the name of God, to bless God for who he is, to praise him for the wondrous God that he is, because he is worthy of all our praise and worship. And so this morning isn't about what we get from it, but about what we give to it and what we give to God. Wherever we are, whoever we may be with or without, whether we're on our own, it's about honouring God in any way we can. And to be able to do that online is quite a remarkable thing, I think, and I'm glad that we can do that this morning. So let's just take a moment's stillness and quiet to prepare our hearts and minds to meet with God together. And then I'll pray the prayer for this Sunday in Lent, and then we'll have our opening hymn together. So let's just be still and be silent and pray. Almighty God, whose most dear Son went not up to joy, but first suffered pain, and entered not into glory before he was crucified, mercifully grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it none other than the way of life and peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And so we sing together our opening hymn.
Good morning. Today's reading is taken from Mark chapter 8, verses 27 to 38. Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages around Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked them, "Who do people say I am?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, and still others one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Peter answered, "You are the Christ." Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about him. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men." Then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, "If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels." This is the word of the Lord.
So you may remember at the start of the year when I said that we were going to be doing the lectionary, I said one of the wonderful things about following the lectionary with its various set readings is it will lead us to places where we wouldn't naturally choose to go. If we're doing a sermon series around a theme, then we pick and choose the passages and we find ones that support that theme. And often we can skip over passages that are the more difficult passages or passages we wouldn't choose. And I think actually, if we're honest, this is one of those passages. This is one of those ones that when I sat down to prepare this one, I took a big swallow and a big deep breath and said, "Okay, Holy Spirit, I need you here. I need your help in this," because there is so much in this passage, so much in these few verses that is really significant. But it's also one of those passages that many people find really, really hard, because you seem in this moment to have Jesus almost a little bit out of character, a little bit out of the way we know him. And there are so many questions around this passage. Did Peter suddenly become possessed by the devil? What's going on here in this story? What's going on in this moment? And actually, you know, the verses leading up to it where Jesus is oddly saying to people not to tell anyone about him, even though they've just discovered, "Oh, you're the Christ, you're the one who's been promised," and he's asking them to keep that quiet, and there's questions around why is Jesus doing that. Maybe it's something to do with the fact that he wants people to form their own opinions of him and not be influenced by the opinions of others. Maybe it's just because there's something more to be done before he's ready to make that a public declaration of who he is. Maybe it's because there's something going on behind the scenes that we just don't know. But there's so much in this passage. There's so much in these verses that we tend to skip over. People often pick and choose the bits they like out of this. You know, often people will use the, "Oh, he must deny himself and pick up his cross and follow me," as a verse that they quote and hold to heart and memorize. But actually, the context of it is so important as well. So before we get any further, let's pray. Let's just ask the Spirit to do what only the Spirit can do and help us with this, because the thing about the Bible is it's only as good as our interpretation of it, in that sense that we all interpret scripture differently and we're all going to have different interpretations of this passage. And I'm not professing that what I'm going to say this morning is the interpretation or the only interpretation or even necessarily the right interpretation, but just really what has helped me reflect on this difficult passage this week. And so let's just pray. Let's just commit it to Jesus and say, "Okay, come and have your way." And so that is our request, God. We thank you that your word is living and breathing and active. And so that whenever we approach your word, whenever we read your word, you are there available to speak to us. And even in those passages that we find hard, even those passages that we don't fully understand, there is something there that can show us there's more of you and more of who you are and more of your glory. And we pray that in these few moments, as we reflect on these few verses, we pray that you would be speaking to us by your Spirit, that you'd be inspiring us and encouraging us and challenging us, and maybe even disturbing us enough to bring about change in our lives. So we invite you, Holy Spirit, to do your work as we reflect on your word. In your name. Amen. So it's an unusual passage, isn't it? I mean, it's just so full of so much that you have this kind of declaration of Jesus as the Christ. You have almost like the disciples having this moment of revelation where Peter has pieced it all together and he's worked out that Jesus is the Messiah, he's the chosen one, he's worked out he is the one who has come. And then moments later, Jesus is beginning to say that he's going to die. That not only is he going to die, but he's going to be hated and rejected by all the religious authorities and leaders and people in authority. They're going to hate him. They're going to reject him, and they're going to put him on a cross, and they're going to kill him. And then 3 days later, he's going to rise from the dead. And you can imagine this kind of sea of emotion in this scene, can't you? And just as the disciples hear this about their beloved Messiah, as they hear these words about their rabbi who they've come to know and to love, he's become their best friend. I think particularly for Peter, he's found a real connection with Jesus here. And suddenly he's talking about dying. I don't know if you've ever been part of a conversation and halfway through the conversation, or maybe halfway through listening to a sermon, you just glaze over. Maybe because you're tired or you're just not focused, you just glaze over, and so you don't hear the whole thing, and maybe you miss the main point of that conversation. Or maybe you've been in that situation where someone has said something that's made you so angry that you weren't able to hear the rest of what they said because you were just so focused on what they just said that has incensed you and made you so mad. And so you failed to hear the context, you failed to get the big picture. How often in media are things that people said just taken way out of context, that maybe one sentence that they said is taken way out of context, and they're brandished as being a really bad person for saying that thing, when actually there's a wider context in which they said that thing, which makes you realize there's a different story altogether. And far too often we are taking things out of their context and we're not understanding the full picture. And I don't know about you, but I kind of imagine that happening with Peter in this scene, that as Jesus is talking about the fact he's going to die, the fact he's going to be rejected and hated by the religious authorities, by all those in authority, that Peter, in his usual loving hot-headedness, is incensed by this idea. And it's like, no, Jesus, that can't possibly happen. There's no way that could happen. I mean, I'd imagine you'd be the same if you had somebody, a good friend of yours, and who was like 31 years old, saying they're about to die. You would contest that, wouldn't you? Surely you'd say, no, there's got to be another way. This isn't the way. And so Peter is incensed, and maybe he doesn't necessarily fully hear the bit about the resurrection. Or maybe actually he's just misunderstanding it, because the Jewish idea of the resurrection would have been very different to how we understand it in a post-Jesus world. Now, we know now that Jesus meant very literally he was going to rise from the dead. But to the people of Israel, to Jews at that time, that wouldn't have been what they would have imagined with the word resurrection. They would have thought about the resurrection of all people. And so it would have been a very different understanding, a very different interpretation of that word resurrection. They wouldn't have imagined that Jesus was talking about physically resurrecting himself 3 days later from the dead. And so he's hearing this story of just Jesus dying, and he's incensed by this. And so Peter takes Jesus aside. Now, I love that. I love the fact that, first of all, that Peter feels bold enough and brave enough to take Jesus aside. And I love the fact that Jesus allows Peter to take him aside. that such is their relationship, such is their friendship, such is their level of trust between one another, that they're able to have this moment. Now, I know I've spoken before about the age of the disciples in previous talks, and that actually there's quite a lot of thinking and research to suggest that the disciples were much more likely to be older teenagers and younger adults rather than men with beards, how we picture them. Now, we know Peter was married, and even though people got married much younger in those days, it's thought that Peter maybe is slightly elder and is possibly the kind of leader of the group of disciples after Jesus, almost like a second in command or the one that people would look up to. And so it's thought that Peter took Jesus aside to speak to him on behalf of how all the disciples were feeling. And it says, and it's mind-blowing to think of this, isn't it? When you think about who Jesus is, who they've just proclaimed Jesus to be, Peter rebukes Jesus. Now, I looked up the word rebuke this week, and it basically means to be so angry, to disagree so much with what somebody has said that you're angry. You're angry at what they've said, and you just can't agree with what they said. And so Peter is saying these things about Jesus. It can't be this way. That's not how it's going to be. People aren't going to hate you that much, surely. No, you can't die. It can't be like that. You can't leave us on our own. We've only just got to know you. We've just recognized you as the Christ. It can't be this way. And in some ways, you read this passage and you think, how ridiculous of Peter to be able to rebuke Jesus in that way, to be able to speak to Jesus like that. But the reality is, you know what? We do it all the time. I mean, how many times have you in your prayer said, God, this isn't fair. God, why is it like this? God, it shouldn't be like this. This isn't how life should go. We have these moments where something feels or seems to be not right. And in our anger and our frustration, in our hurt and our pain, we cry out to God. And do you know what? It's all right to do that. It's good to do that. Jesus let Peter do that. Jesus let Peter have his vent, his moment of rebuking. And Peter just poured out. And we don't know exactly what he said in his rebuke, but I would imagine it was along these lines, because we know that Peter says these things later as well. Jesus, that's never going to happen. No, it's not going to be like that. No, we'll never leave you. We'll never let that happen. And so he's rebuking Jesus. And then whilst that's happening, Jesus is hearing everything Peter's saying. Peter is being seen. He's being heard by Jesus. And then there's this remarkable moment where Jesus looks at Peter. And it says, even in the passage that we heard, that he looks at the disciples. Now, they're probably stood somewhere a little bit out of earshot. Maybe they can hear certain aspects of this conversation, particularly as it is clearly heated. It's clearly it's clearly not a quiet whisper conversation. Maybe it is, but either way, the disciples are there, and Jesus looks at the disciples and he looks at Peter, and then it says that he rebukes Peter and then says, "Get behind me, Satan, for the things you're thinking, the things you're speaking are of the mind of man, not of the mind of God." And that's the bit that people struggle with, because it just seems so out of character, first of all, of Jesus to speak to somebody like that. Why is Jesus suddenly rebuking Peter in such a difficult way? And then the way he speaks, and then he's having this conversation with Satan, saying, "Get behind me, Satan," as if somehow Peter has suddenly become possessed by the enemy and is speaking on his behalf. And is this an exorcism? What's going on in this moment? Well, there's a number of different thoughts around this. There's a number of different reflections around this, and I've been journeying through some of those this week as I've been trying to understand this passage more myself. And there are some who say that Jesus was saying this kind of like semi-seriously, but to kind of almost jokingly. I don't buy that necessarily. There are some who say that Jesus is not talking to Peter himself, but actually what happens here is you have kind of two separate events that are actually two separate sentences in the original language. And so Jesus rebukes Peter, full stop, and then he says, "Get behind me, Satan." And so what that suggestion is that something else is going on there, which we'll come to in a minute, because I think the root of what's going on is still the same. And then there's some who say that actually, obviously, Jesus isn't speaking to Peter necessarily in the sense that he's speaking to the enemy who is influencing perhaps Peter. So not that Peter has become possessed, but he's certainly being influenced by the enemy, by temptations of the enemy, to think a certain way, to respond a certain way to what Jesus has said. Because what Jesus has just done in talking about his death and his resurrection is he's revealed the will of God. And so the enemy is going to try and come up against that and try and put a stop to that will. And so he's perhaps whispering to Peter or persuading Peter or just using Peter's general humanness, his general human emotion to be incensed by this and to try to derail the will of God by talking Jesus out of it, essentially. Now, however you look at that, whichever way you look at it, there is significant thing here going on. The fact that Jesus's words of "get behind me" are directed towards Satan, not to Peter. And that's important because there's something I think we do with Jesus, something I know I've been guilty of with Jesus, is that we tend to imagine his times of temptation or limit Jesus's times of temptation to the wilderness, the 40 days in the wilderness that we remembered just a couple of weeks ago, and perhaps the Garden of Gethsemane. And we think about those two times where specifically it mentions that Jesus is tempted. Yet we find out elsewhere in Scripture that Jesus was tempted in every way, yet was without sin. And so here's one thing that could be seen about this passage, and particularly when you look at the words that Jesus uses. Because he says, "Get behind me, Satan, for you speak the things of man, not the things of God." Now, is it possible that in this moment that Jesus has shared about his death and his resurrection? Now, we know from the Garden of Gethsemane that Jesus is totally surrendered to God's will, but at the same time, that humanness of him is torn by that, is torn by what's going to happen, by what's going on. And there's no doubt in my mind at all that Jesus has an emotional connection with his disciples, that they have become friends, really good friends. He's not just a rabbi with students. These are becoming a group of close companions. They've got this respect and trust with one another enough for them to be able to rebuke one another. And that maybe in this moment that Jesus is thinking on those things, is thinking on what Peter has said, because he hasn't just dismissed Peter, he hasn't ignored Peter, he's listened to what Peter has said. And then in that moment, he looks at the disciples and he looks at Peter and he sees how upset they are. And maybe for a split second, a brief moment, Jesus thinks, oh, maybe it doesn't have to be this way. You know, look at what it's doing to my friends. Look at what it's doing, what this plan is doing. Look at how much hurt it could cause. And for a brief split second, Jesus thinks maybe it doesn't have to be this way. Maybe Peter's got it right. And then he instantly recognizes where that kind of thought comes from the enemy, from that the one who is against the will of God. And then he rebukes Peter, saying, "No, Peter, you need to understand. It has to be this way. This is the way it's going to be. This is what is going to happen. Even if you don't want it to happen this way, this is what is going to happen because this is the will of the Father, which I'm going to fulfill in order to save the world." And then he says, "Get behind me, Satan." Because in that moment, it's possible that Jesus was tempted to fear man more than he was to fear God. And we know we're all guilty of that at times, aren't we? That we feel that what we need to do is please other people. And often we do that at the detriment of pleasing God. But actually, God may have called us to do something, but we know it's difficult, or we know it might upset people, or we know that people might not agree with it, or that we fear their response more than we fear God's. Or maybe in terms of looking for affirmation, we want their response more than we want God's. You know, I've been through that in a personal journey this past couple of weeks with my book, where I've just been hungry for feedback. And actually, God's already given me feedback on that book. God's already told me what he thinks about that book. So what other people think shouldn't matter to me as much, but it still does, doesn't it? Because that's the way we seem to be wired. But that fear of man more than God has led to so many people doing things against the will of God. And in that moment, Jesus has that temptation to give into the will of God in order to please his friends. But in that second, he recognizes where that comes from. and far more powerfully than he rebuked Peter, he rebukes Satan. And he says, "Get behind me, for you speak the will of man, not the will of God." And maybe that just makes Peter just stand up and realise what's happened. Maybe that brings a slight revelation for Peter to recognise, oh yeah, you're right. I surrender to God's will. And we know that Peter still struggles with that. It's an ongoing battle with Peter. As we see throughout the Gospels, this whole thing between fulfilling the will of God, but at the same time, Jesus is his best friend and he doesn't want to see him suffer the way that he's going to suffer. And we have this bigger picture now as post-resurrection people, but Peter didn't have that. And so in his humanity, he's just torn apart by wanting to fulfill the will of God and at the same time, the prospect of losing his best mate. And so that in that moment, I think Jesus is just revealing to the disciples, reminding himself, showing Peter that the will of God is far greater than the will of man. And what he does then is goes on incredibly. And we haven't got time to look at this incredible discourse now where he talks about taking up your cross and choosing life with him. But one thing I will say is that the picking up your cross and following Jesus is one of those countercultural things that just seems so opposite to being the thing to do, because it's like you're intentionally choosing suffering. It's like you're intentionally choosing pain. To pick up your cross and follow Jesus, it's everything to do with humility and surrender and all those things that we struggle with and find difficult. But as we just prayed at the beginning of this service, the prayer for today is, may we find that picking up our cross, that the way of the cross is the way of peace and life. Because that's how upside down, or actually how right way up, God's kingdom is. We know that blessed are those who are poor in spirit, that those who suffer are going to find joy and peace and life and hope, because that's what's found in the way of Jesus. That's what's found in life with Jesus. And as we pick up our cross and follow Jesus, although it will lead to suffering, it will lead to perhaps rejection from others, people thinking we're crazy, people not believing the things that we believe, people ridiculing Jesus as being ridiculous. If we pick up our cross and follow Jesus, if we choose life with him, then that's where we find life and peace. And it seems so countercultural, doesn't it? But it's the right way up. Because our God is a God who cares, has passion for the oppressed and the suffering. And so when we, in humility, make that decision to pick up our cross and follow Jesus, we are finding life and peace. And so we might think that taking up our cross is a really horrible burden that we have to bear. And yes, there is an element of burden because it means walking alongside the suffering and the hurting. You know, I was listening to something this week that was talking about true worship, and true worship being that whole kind of love, justice, act, you know, the thing we talked about fasting a few weeks ago, that God's desire is that we care for the orphan, the broken, the hurting, the widow. And that true worship isn't just about feeding the hungry, but it's about loving those in need. It's about loving God's people. And there is an element of sacrifice and suffering in that. But Jesus knows that in order for us to have true life and true peace, it's only found in walking in his way. And his way is in the self-sacrificial, loving way of the cross. That's the call. Self-sacrificial loving. And it's not easy. You know, people often think that we preach, you know, too much love in the church, as if love is the easy option. But it's not. Love is by far the harder option, because love hurts. When it's self-sacrificial love, when it's the way of the cross, when it's picking up your cross and following Jesus, love is not easy, far from easy. Love hurts sometimes. But in that place, when we choose that, when we walk in that way, when we choose that repentance of choosing to live in the way of Jesus, we find life and peace. And we not only find that, we find salvation and hope as well. And we find life in all its fullness and all those things that Jesus has promised us. It's not a whole life of woe is me. It's a life of walking with Christ, walking in the way of Christ, which is to pick up our cross and follow him. But in that is life and peace. I had a dream last night that helped me to picture this in some way, because the whole concept of picking up our cross and following Christ is about surrender. It is about laying down ourselves and our desires in order to surrender to the will of God and the heart of God, because God knows he is what is best for us. And yet we walk through life carrying so many things we need not carry, and holding on to things that we really shouldn't be holding on to, whether that's our own pride or whether it's things from our past that we're just not prepared to let go of, or things of our character, or whatever it may be. And there are things that we're just not prepared to surrender to God. But in order to pick up a cross, your hands need to be empty. You know, picking up a cross is a two-handed job. You cannot do it with just one hand. And so in order to pick up your cross and follow Jesus, your hands need to be empty. And I kind of had this dream. I had this dream last night that you imagine you are walking along a river, and you have in your hands things that are important to you, things that you use every day, things that that matter. Maybe you got your phone in your hand, because that's what a lot of people seem to have these days when they're walking along, or you've got things that are important to you in your hands, maybe your diary or your keys for your house or whatever it may be, and you're walking along and somebody falls in the river. Now, I'd like to think that you wouldn't hesitate to throw that stuff down and dive in and save that person. That the things that matter to you suddenly won't matter because there's somebody else in greater need than you. And the things that you have just get their perspective, don't they? Just suddenly there is a perspective given to these things and they don't matter as much anymore. Well, imagine now that you are the one in the river. And if you want to see yourself be saved, then what do you need to lay down in order to surrender to the will of God and allow him to save you? I know that's a kind of a backwards picture and it all kind of gets a bit jumbled in the way, and to be honest, I'm still working it out, but it's this whole kind of sense of actually surrendering the things that we're holding on to in order to allow Jesus to reach in and save us. And then to live in his way, to surrender to him fully so that our hands are available to him. And to walk in the way of Christ, that is the way of the cross, which is self-sacrificial love. But what we know that Peter couldn't know is that on the other side of that is resurrection, is life in all its fullness. And so we have this wonderful paradox where it's not a case of pick up your cross and suffer and follow him or have resurrection and life. It's both and. That we can have both of those things. I was talking to someone this morning after the service at St. Mark's about the mystery of God, that it is that God is incredibly mysterious, that he is unexplainable. You can't explain God. But yet at the same time, he's relatable. This wonderful paradox that we have as Christians is that we are called to take up our cross and follow him. We are called to walk in a way of self-sacrificial loving. But at the same time, we have life in all its fullness. And that the way of the cross, because Jesus' kingdom is so upside down to this one, but actually, as we said, is the right way up, that in that place, we find life and peace. So may we be a people who are willing to fear God more than we fear man. And may we choose to acknowledge Jesus as the Lord of our lives that he is. And may we choose the way of Jesus, which is the way of self-sacrificial love, the way of the cross. And as we choose to take up our cross, may we surrender fully to him, knowing that his ways are the ways in which we find love, life, and peace. Amen. As I said, it's quite a lot in just a few verses, more than I think I imagined there being in that passage. And as I said, that's just the journey I've been on with that passage this week and even just this morning. And by no means reached my destination with that, but that's the joy of Scripture, isn't it? That when we come across these passages, that, as I said, when we come across a passage we don't understand, it's an invitation from the Holy Spirit to say, come and get to know Jesus better. And that's a wonderful, wonderful invitation. We're going to have some song worship now, which Steve is going to lead us in as we respond to what God might be saying to us this morning as the call is to come and follow. Amen.
I owe all to you. between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living God. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living God. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began
Just spend a moment just in stillness and in quiet, just allowing the Spirit to seal in our hearts and minds whatever it is he may have been doing this morning. Holy Spirit, we thank you for your presence with us. We thank you for the life that you invite us to lead. and the privilege that that life is. And so we surrender ourselves again to you and say, come and have your way, Lord Jesus. Would you seal in our hearts and minds the things that you've revealed to us this morning? Would you let the things that are not of you fall away and the things that are of you be rooted deep within our hearts and minds and lives? May we choose your will. May we choose your way. May we choose self-sacrificial love. And in that place, may we find life and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for your world. We pray for those in leadership and authority that they would fear God more than man. That they would choose your ways and choose to hear your voice. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those we know and love who are struggling and suffering this day. That as we perhaps suffer with them and alongside them, that you would give them the peace and comfort they need today, but also that your healing power would be present in their lives. We pray too for those who are mourning today, that casting all their care on you, they may know the full consolation of your perfect love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And again, we pray for ourselves. May we be willing to take up our cross and follow you, and to make you the number one in our lives once again. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And let's just sum all of that up and all of this morning up by praying together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. So we hope and pray that this morning has been helpful to you, and that you feel that God has been perhaps speaking to you in some way. I want to encourage you and remind you that after this service, we have a couple of people available for prayer ministry on the phone. So if you, if God has stirred something in you that you feel needs dealing with, or that you want to share with somebody, or you feel you need to share with somebody, then they will be available. Their details will appear on the screen at the end of the service, and you can give them a call after the service for just a chance to process and to chat. Or if you don't want to use them, then make sure you phone somebody you know and love and trust to be able to process those things with. If God stirred it in you this morning, stirred something in you, then maybe there's something that he wants you to address, but also you're not called to focus on that alone or to deal with that alone. So do reach out to your brothers and sisters around you and receive the support that the community would so desperately love to give you, albeit in a slightly more unusual way. But do make use of your phone and reach out should you need to. But yeah, just make use of that. Also, we'll be having coffee on Zoom after the service as well. Details of that will appear on the screen as well of how to access that. Just a couple of things by way of notice. The first is to say that on next Sunday, our service at St. Mark's is going to be at 10 a.m. because it's the first Sunday of the month. So service at St. Mark's at 10 a.m. If you would like to attend that service, then please do let me know before next Sunday. That would be great. And then the online service will be 10:30 as normal. Will be an all-age service put together by our children and young people. So that's next Sunday. Just to say, our United Prayer Gathering, which would normally be on the first Sunday of the month, is actually going to move this month and is going to be on Tuesday the 9th of March. So the United Prayer Gathering on Zoom will be on Tuesday the 9th of March, not as normal on the 2nd. So Tuesday the 9th of March, 7:45 on Zoom, for those who want to gather to pray for the church and for the world and for whatever God lays on our hearts, and to spend some time seeking and hearing from God. So that's Tuesday the 9th of March. This coming Saturday, the 6th of March, is our Bible Trivia Quiz Night on Zoom. It's for all ages, all are welcome. It's this coming Saturday at 6 p.m. It's just going to be for 45 minutes or so. It's not going to be massively long, but it's a chance, really. It's a chance to have some fun together, but also in the hope that we will learn some things about the Bible that we perhaps never knew before as we go through the course of the evening, because not only will there be questions, but when we give the answers, there will be odd little facts and you know, insights thrown in as well. So it's a way to see it as a fun way of doing an extended Bible study where we're going to be looking at the Bible as a whole, some well-known stories. As I said before, we've now worked out a way that if you are with others in the household, we're going to make it so that it's fair for people who are on their own against people who are as families. And as I said before as well, and I think this is really important, that one of the things that can put people off coming to a Bible trivia quiz night is that they're worried they're going to look a bit silly, or that maybe there's things that they should know that they don't know and they don't want to be embarrassed by what they don't know. Just to say, at no point in the evening will you be sharing either your answers or your results with other people. It will be entirely just a kind of, you know, you'll be partaking and answering the questions, but you won't be sharing your results or your answers with anybody other than the people in your household. So don't worry about looking silly. The hope is that we will all come away having learned something that we never knew before about God's word and how exciting it is to approach God's word. So to do that in a way that's fun and engaging, hopefully for all ages. So that is this Saturday, 6 p.m. on Zoom. Details of how to access that are in the notice sheet. If you haven't received the notice sheet or you haven't yet read the notice sheet, then please do check your emails to make sure it's there, and the details of the Zoom that you need to access that next Saturday will be there. So join us for that if you can. I just want to urge and encourage you this week to pray for our schools in the parish. For those who don't know, we've got five primary schools in our parish. They are Handcross Park School, Handcross Primary School, Warningley Primary School, St. Mark's Primary School, and then Branchridge School in Staplefield as well. Please do bear those schools in mind as they prepare for children to return next week. There's a lot for those schools to go through. Particularly St. Mark's, tomorrow we have a meeting of our governors, so please do pray for that as we kind of process what the next few weeks is going to look like for our schools and for the families affected by the changes coming into play. So please do remember our schools in your prayers, particularly this week. That would be appreciated. So as I said, do join us on Zoom for coffee after the service if you're able to. But for now, let's pray God's blessing as we draw this service to a close before we sing our final hymn together. And so may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and in the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you, with those you love, with those you should love today and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.